right now. Lord, in your presence, we are changed. In your presence, we are changed, Lord. No matter how we walked in here tonight, Jesus, in your presence, we are changed. We fix our eyes on you right now. We fix our eyes on you, Jesus, and pray that you would just wipe away the distractions, Lord. Let all other things just fade away. Right now, we fix our eyes on you. Thank you. Oh, he's
Thank you. Yeah.
on, can we just praise the Lord right now? Can we just lift up a shout of praise to Him? One more time, and just say hello to somebody that you don't know or you haven't seen in a while. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
I recognize you from the conference.
Yeah.
You were being proactive.
That's for sure. Seen them probably in a while, but to some of that definition, some would qualify that it, well, it's been 2 days since I've seen them. That's a long time. I got to speak to everybody in the room. So, but I just thank so much for Georgie doing that. Leading us there, and since the words are flying. Yeah, you. Did you just fly in from, or come in from up north?
No, I went up north.
Oh, you weren't, okay. I thought you were up there. But anyway, it's still good to see you, whether you're up north or not. But there's a reflection. Well, I think we sang the old doxology there at the last or something, you know. I hadn't sung that in 100 years. But, you know, it's been more than just reminiscing around our table this afternoon with Danny. But just looking at some of the mamas and the papas the Lord's raising up. And even then, I think the Lord, I kept seeing, I was trying to run it by Patty, I kept seeing an unfolding taking place in our lives. And I could just see Jesus unfolding the bread, you know, before He broke it. And Georgie just did a great job who does anything anymore. God, through Georgie, did a great job of just unfolding the presence of God, and just thank her so much for that. But I think he's unfolding some other things, and with the old thing, Danny, there's been a lot of things. I've been to different conferences, and we might need this pen, Vineyard and so forth, and I heard the Lord say to me, I'm calling you. And I don't, has anyone, did anybody hear that today? I'm calling you. I mean, you don't have, yeah, there's no pressure. There's no pressure. But I think kind of right in here somewhere, the Lord is doing a calling, and really, I just reminisce when I was 9 years old, I was baptized. Katie got saved at one day old. But it took me a while for it to really take, and I fell away in the 7th grade, and 8th, and 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th grade. But I finally got back on target at 18 years old, and I just think right in here there's a calling taking place. And I believe, I pray that you will hear those words this week, this weekend, that I'm calling you. And because he's really calling. I think for some in the room, I saw a fork in the road, and it was a three-pronged fork. And I think a three-pronged fork you usually eat hors d'oeuvres or shrimp cocktail with or something like that. And I think for some of you, you're passing the hors d'oeuvre of the Christian life and moving on into the meat of the matter. And you know, it's, some of us have stayed too long around the appetizers, and there's really deeper and deeper, and you will come to a fork in the road. You will come. And that's why I keep saying, really, to some teenagers, and even around in here, there's a fork in the road. There's really a need to press in, and really just turn it over to Jesus. And I read this. I flipped over my Bible. Stephanie, you were looking at me when I did this, but come to me, all you are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. And for my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. And I tried to quote that to Danny on the way in from the airport, and I just happened to open up my Bible to it. But I'm coming to a place where there's more and more forks in the road. You know, pastoring isn't a job that you really, you know, you long for, you know, in all way. If you do, then you quickly understand that there's more to it than holding a microphone. And I wouldn't do anything else, by the way. But you see where there's more and more heavy burdens. And I don't know if that ever happens to you, but it's time to get over the appetizer and coming into the presence of the Lord, because in the rest, there are answers. In the presence, in the rest, you all of a sudden you can give your burdens to Him, and your load is light. Now that sounds like something a preacher would say, or let's go around the room at Sunday school. Scott, why don't you start us out? Where have you let the Lord take your burden? No, we're not going to do that. Because a lot of just, you know, simplistic Sunday school answers, or I like Sunday school, but simplistic answers isn't necessarily the thing. It talks about entering the rest. And I've just come to realize in the last month that I've had transformation, I've had change, I've had just unreal things take place in the rest. And I'm learning to take, I understand what the old preacher said. I've got so many things to do today, if I don't spend 3 hours in prayer, I won't get them all done. And you've got to enter the rest. And I came in heavy laden this past Thursday, and Zach was leading worship, and all of his intercessory prayer was, I can't do it by myself. I'm willing, I'm able, but I can't do it. I can't do it. Lord, you got to do it. You got to do it. And that's where we are. And we come here tonight on a Friday night. God bless you. Coming here on a Friday night for the rest to come. It's just too much. We're not created for this. You understand that, don't you? We're not created to handle it without Jesus. And I just pray that you'll come to that fork in the road and move on, because there's trouble at the fork. There's suffering at the fork. There's process, like the way Graham Cook says. And then you go through process. What does he mean by process? But you're going through process, and I'm just here to tell you that it gets better and better and better. And we're so thankful for Danny to be here just to lead us in that direction during this conference. But we're going to take up an offering if some people would grab some baskets. There's a card reader in the back. The Lord said, you don't have to tell them what you're going to do with this offering. And I said, okay. But it's going to this conference. It's going to the needs and the different things that are happening at this conference. And God bless you on this. We just ask the Lord to bless it. Lord, we enter the rest and just give us the number of what to give. Maybe tomorrow night. It's okay. Tomorrow night or Sunday morning. Lord, we're going to give to you. And even though we want that vacation, so bad. Oh, my goodness. And the condo down there is $3,000 a week. My goodness, Lord. But, Lord, we're going to give into that. We're going to give because of our treasure is in heaven. Our treasure, our focus is in heaven. Our focus is the kingdom of God. And, Lord, we give you praise and glory. We pray, Lord, that you would download your kingdom this weekend, and that in powerful ways we'll see how to reach our neighborhood. We'll see how to reach our neighbors. We'll see how to do the stuff, the kingdom's stuff, the healing, the raising of the dead, the evangelizing the heart, the causing eyes, blind eyes to see. The leper will touch the lepers. Oh, we're going to touch lepers. Oh, we're going to touch the ugly, unlovely leper and see healing, Lord.
All right.
And we thank you, Lord, for your kingdom. We thank you for all you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen. We got this, our little Haitian friend, or is that politically incorrect? I can't say. We've got a little friend from Haiti, and he came out of our bathroom. He's been in there for about 2 months. And how am I doing so far?
They just let him out.
And as he came out of our bathroom after 2 months, now he's been doing some remodeling. And Anity, we'll talk about him tonight because he'll be here Sunday. But we were just relating to him how long we've known Danny, and we didn't get to half of it. But Danny showed up in our living room on a Friday night, 2011. Yeah. So we've had this burden to carry for 12 years now. It's been just a huge walk with the Lord. It's just been fantastic walking with Danny and all the different exploits and things that he does. And we're just really excited that Danny, I don't know why people keep coming back. I don't know, but Danny came back. And he loves us anyway, in spite of me. And I appreciate it so much. Danny was just down in Colombia. South America, he's going back to South. Should I advertise this, or are all the trips full? All right, man, you say something. All right, come down. Yeah.
Actually, it was in October. I think I was here right after the October trip, was I? Is that not right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Too much stuff in my hands. Sorry. And actually at that time was pretty much the height of, I'm going to be really honest about a bunch of stuff tonight. Is that okay?
Yes.
Can I just be real with you?
Yes.
I want to. Holy Spirit really wants to minister here tonight. And in fact, all weekend, I've come off of the most incredible day. I'll share that with you as well. But in October, we I took a team to Colombia, South America, and it was incredible. My brother was actually with me, and it's the first trip that we've ever done together in missions. He's 6 years older than me, has been on gazillion missions, including Haiti, many in Haiti, and he said, my life is forever changed. He said, I'll never do missions the way I've done it before. And we have a team that we've developed over there that is a growing team, continuing to do the stuff, continuing to what we just kind of got them lit. We took them to places in the city they'd never been because they were told it was too dangerous. And the reality of missions, just to help you, is Jesus said, come and die. That's what he said. I mean, if you're afraid of losing your life, you aren't a disciple even yet. Did you hear me? It's not about church. I'm going to talk pretty real about a lot of things. And so when I came, I was not at my heaviest. My heaviest actually was back in January 1st, 22. And I was at 397. I was like, ain't no way I'm going to ever hit 400. Not going to do it. So I began doing all kinds of weird stuff the whole year. But I had excruciating pain. And I'd had that for, at that point, already a year. And it was getting worse and worse and worse. And but at that point in time, I went to Colombia. The doctor had me on meds. I'm going to even tell you what the meds were. Because I was on 40 megs of prednisone a day plus 18,000 of gabapentin.
Oh, wow.
And I literally was, almost fell off the stage. Twice, I collapsed in front of my team three times, just dropped, had no strength. I once fell backwards down some steps and people caught me. I was using a cane at that point in time. I actually, I called my doctor from there and I said, something's not working here. Number one, I was in still agony and a lot of pain. And I said, but I'm going to wean myself from this stuff. And they said, don't be stupid. It's too early and can't do it that fast. I said, I don't really care. And I began. And what I wouldn't realize is that I went through about a 2-month withdrawal. I stopped them both within probably a week. But the pain was so agonizing. There was no position I was in that I was comfortable in any way, shape, or form. None. It didn't matter. And it was 24/7, 9-10 level pain. It was just horrific. And I was like, wow. I ended up literally on a walker. I basically, in those days, I was able to do about 10 steps. I couldn't stand for more than 7 minutes. Everything you ever saw me preaching during that period of time was me sitting, maybe standing for just a short period and then sitting back down. Saw some incredible miracles. Saw some miracles in Colombia that were astounding. I'm like, this is ridiculous. I'm praying for people who are in not as bad a shape as me. They're getting healed and I'm like stuck here, Lord, what's the deal? He taught me a lot. And actually, that began actually last April and when I went to South Africa. And he said this to me. He said, because I was like, God, I can't do this. I reached a point, literally reached a point. I said, God, this is too painful. I cannot live like this. I'm ready to come home. Just bring me home. And but he'd given me a word. And he'd given it a number of years ago, probably somewhere around 2005 or 6. I had same dream multiple times a night for 2.5 weeks. Exact same dream over and over and over. And I went to every dream interpreter I knew that was good at it. I'd already done it, and I thought I knew what it said, but it was just too bizarre for me. But in that, but that dream basically was, I was 118 years old. I was standing and I was preaching the gospel, and I was like, wow, Lord, this is crazy. Yeah. It's kind of funny because the precious woman that we have in New England this past week, she sends me a couple articles. One was about a 100-year-old couple one day apart. And then the other one, this is so cool. The oldest man in Tunisia makes it to 119. And I was like, so evidently everybody knows, and now I look like an idiot, but I was like, I said, Lord, science wouldn't say that. Medicine would never say that, particularly in the shape I'm in. And he said, I do not take my counsel from scientists and doctors. He said, I don't need them. He said, I'm God. And part of the procedure that God is doing with the church right now is ridding us from the statements and the things that we believe we will incur in our lives that have nothing to do with the Spirit of God or what God has intended for our lives. And so, you know, he's saying that to me in the middle of it, and he says, by the way, you told me you would go anytime, any place, and do anything for me a long time ago. He said, so if you have to crawl because you're in so much pain, I'm telling you, you have to go.
Wow.
That was in South Africa. That was before that. But then we had the thing in Colombia. Then I go through about 2 months. It was horrific. I had this chair at home, and I would, in the middle of meetings, I'd be there talking, and I'd just have to recline all the way, and it was weird. I mean, watching those live feeds is like, where'd he go? I'm just reclining like I can't handle this, and it's and through all that, are you ready for this? Through all that, there were a few times that others would do worship, but most of the time the Lord said, you have to do worship. What are you making me do? By the way, I want to say something to Dwight Candy real quick, and I'll carry on. Your heart for the Lord. I thought about David as we were worshiping. I thought, oh. And he said, do you remember what I said to David? He said, because of his heart, I would never cease to have someone sit on my throne. The Lord says, you will never cease to have the most remarkable worship in here.
Amen.
And it's not coming from where you think it's coming from. It's coming from what he is doing. And you have absolutely, absolutely released an atmosphere where worship happens. It doesn't matter who's doing it. It's the most remarkable thing. That doesn't happen. And very kind of cool. But anyways, I think it's cool. Anybody think that's cool? I love you. So the Lord has, through a number of circumstances, and most of you, Mary will be here tomorrow. And I'll just tell you, Mary tried to help me 2 years ago, and I had a taste of something. I said, ain't no way I can do that. That's the truth. I just was like, no. And so I refused it. Well, they did x-rays of me in December. They found out that I'm 100% bone on bone on both my hips, as well as my L4, 5, S1. Everything's impacted. Everything's crushing. All that deteriorated. All this stuff. I had sciatica down both of my legs. And it was insane. And so anyway, so she texted me and she said, you sure you wouldn't like to do this? I don't know. The Lord showed me the picture of the guy in the boat going past the guy on the rooftop who's been praying for help. And he says, I'm waiting on God. And so I began. And it's been a remarkable journey. Today, as of February, all told, I've lost 127 pounds. I'm just telling you. But that's from last January 1st. But from February, 1 month ago, 3 days ago, I've lost 65 pounds today. And I'm excited about it. I'm like, things have gotten better. I've felt a lot better about a lot of things, but there's still pain. I still have pain. People are like, well, does it still hurt? Yeah, it hurts. But I can tell you that in the past few months, I have danced. I have, in Africa, danced. I mean, like, that's seriously hard dancing. I've done things that I certainly couldn't do for the previous 2 years. And so I'm so grateful to the Lord. I just want to honor him. And I really believe the Lord's going to be honored tonight. Really, you know, I just want everything to go to Jesus tonight. I just want it to look like Jesus. I want tonight to just, Lord, that's what we want. We want tonight to feel like we've been in the presence of Jesus, not some man. I've learned a lot through the whole process. You know, many years ago, I've had 5 physical encounters with Jesus. He's laid hands on me. He's spoken to me. He spent one time over 3 hours in a room with me. One of the coolest took less than probably 5 seconds when he showed up in a room in his entire regal garments. I knew he was in the room earlier, and I said, Lord, I know you're right in front of me. I can feel it, but I can't see you. And he said, you will. Later on that night, literally everyone was on their face before God, everyone, including worship team, drummers, everybody was on their face. The presence of God was so thick, unbelievably thick. And at that point, there's just this incredible awe in the room, and I'm laying face down. He said, look up to the center of the room. And my head's down, and I look up, and I saw him, and he said, put your head down. That was it. And but every time I recognize that, I realize, you know, it says when we see him, we'll be like him, for we become as he is. We will know as we are known. It's the most powerful thing. But one of the most remarkable things that God's been doing in me since 2009, and I'm going to, just because I want you all on the same page when I begin talking about what I'm going to talk about tonight, I'm going to share just a very brief. This is not the full message, but and it might rock you. You may have questions after it. But I've done enough Facebook Lives and other ones on this that you can go find something about what I'm talking about theologically. But in 2009, we had Michael show up in a meeting, the angel Michael. I've seen him probably a dozen times, something like that. And when I saw him, the Lord would evoke all kinds of questions in me, and particularly out of Daniel. And he said, who did Michael show up for? And you begin going through that passage, you begin realizing that Michael is actually showing up for the same guy that shows up in Revelation chapter 1, Jesus. Describes him the same way as John. And I go, oh. And that Jesus could not break through to get to Daniel. And so all the questions are going in my mind, what? The Lord gave me one little thing at that point. He said, do you remember Jacob who wrestled with the pre-incarnate Jesus, the angel of the Lord, and the angel of the Lord could not overpower him? How many of you are involved in worship? For real, because this is like insane. What I'm about to share with you is going to radically, I can barely worship now without weeping, knowing what Jesus did for us. Unbelievable, unbelievable. It is beyond the wildest imagination. And so I'm like, wow. So I began realizing, and then he asked me some questions. When was the Lamb slain? From before the foundation of the world. And then there's this passage in Philippians that says that he didn't think that equality with God was something to grasp, but he laid it all aside. Actually, what happens, are you ready for this? From before the foundations of the earth, when they knew it was going to be needed, that there would have to be not just a sacrifice, but a high priest. One who would in every respect go through what we go through. That it was decided he would lay aside everything. Now, our Sunday school teachers never taught us that.
No.
They did not teach us that Jesus, you ready, laid aside his omnipotence, his all-powerfulness. He laid aside his omniscience, his ability to know everything. And he laid aside his omnipresence. That he was limited. It's the very reason why Jesus would look at us and he'd say, look at his disciples, and he says, it's to your advantage that I'm going. Right now, Holy Spirit's limited on me. He comes in me. He had the Spirit without measure. That's what it says. But he himself, and most of us, we want a meeting with Jesus. Jesus, you come into the meeting, you'll radically affect everything. Let me explain something. Bob Jones shared this one verse with me. This is the short version. Really is the short version. I can go through the whole thing. And now I'm at a point where I recognize this is actual and this is not what I've ever been taught. And God, it is going to freak out some people. And I'll probably get challenged on this over and over. But I can absolutely direct everything to the Word of God. Jesus was, is, and always will be God. It's very important you understand that. I am not in any way diminishing the deity of Christ. But he literally laid that all aside for us. He had to become like us in all respects. He became the perfect obedient son. He didn't just walk into that obedience. He had to learn obedience from what he suffered, is what Hebrews says. That he had to learn to hear, that he could only do what he saw the Father doing. Why? Because he was unable to do it without the Father. He could only speak what he heard the Father saying, because if the Father didn't say it, he had nothing to say. That's why Jesus would walk by the man at the gate beautiful and never heal him. Because the Father never showed him and did not speak to him. Are you with me?
Yeah.
He functioned completely on the obedience to the Holy Spirit, what the Father was showing him. Unbelievable. He literally laid it all aside. Bob Jones shared a verse with me right before he went home to be with the Lord. And he said, the most important scripture in all the Bible is Acts 3:21. I said, what? And in that verse, it says, he must remain in heaven until the restoration of all things. And he says, you think you know what restoration is. It's not about your family. It's not about creation being restored. It's not about any of that. He said the actual place, the moment, are you ready for this? The moment of restoration, this is going to mess your worship leaders up. It messed me up. He is right now with the Father. He is sitting at the right hand of the Father. He ever makes intercession for us. We know that. We know that he carries revelation. We know he speaks revelation. The book of Revelation, incidentally, is not about end times. It's about Jesus. Until you read Revelation with those lenses, you've misunderstood the whole book. You're looking for answers for the days you're living in. And he says, I don't want you to look for answers in the days. I am the answer.
Amen.
For every day. He said, the answer, the moment of restoration is found in Revelation chapter 19. What do you mean? The restoration of all things, you ready for this? Has not happened yet. The restoration of Jesus to the fullness of everything he carried before the before he laid it all aside. You ready? He laid it down then, and it has remained laid down. As a worship, as somebody who loves worship and has been a worship leader, I went, oh my gosh. I'm working for something far different than I thought. I'm not just here to honor the king. I'm here because I want him to have everything that is absolutely his. I want everything restored to Jesus. I want us to find that moment where absolutely every knee will bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father when he returns. And this is what happens. When he returns with a tattoo down his side, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, where he comes with all the hosts of heaven with him, where he absolutely is entering as the full-on God.
Amen.
That he has always been, but did not think equality God with God was something you could grasp. At which moment I want you to hear something. You ready? This is so cool. His omnipotence is fully restored as he begins to rule and reign. His omniscience is completely restored. Ready for this one? His omnipresence is completely restored, and every eye shall see him. But right now, we have Holy Spirit. Who can do, you ready? For our lives. Who has all omnipotence, all omniscience, and all on my presence.
Yeah.
He can be in all of us at the same time. He can move in varying ways. He can release the full power of God through us. He can give you knowledge about things that are way beyond your ability and your understanding. That is not reading, folks. It's a release of his very presence.
Yeah.
I have grown extremely sick of what has been called prophetic ministry. I'm weary of it. The reason I'm weary of it is because God absolutely demands from his very name that the spirit, that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. That Jesus is related to the whole thing with prophecy. If Jesus doesn't show up in a prophetic word, it's not a prophetic word. You just encourage somebody, but that's nice because the Bible says, encourage each other while it is still day. And people have used that term, this is a prophetic word to you. It's not. Prophecy actually has to be supernatural in order to be from God. It should absolutely stir your heart. It should do something. There should probably most often be tears accompanying because you realize Jesus just walked into the room.
Yeah.
Something different is happening than was happening a few minutes ago, and all of a sudden we are there in his very presence. And so I'm going to share some things. I'm going to give you some Kingdom 101, but it's probably not the Kingdom 101 you thought. In just a minute. The day has been amazing. Before I got on the plane this morning, I said, Lord, I'd really love to sit next to somebody who's hungry. I'm sitting down with this one woman, and, you know, she's kind of engrossed in a lot of other things and just, you know, kind of looking out the window, and, because the Lord began speaking to me. Her name is Britt. And I want to get the details because I actually wrote them down because so many things happened today that I don't want to miss it. It was just, it's too much to be able to praise Jesus for. It was one of those days. You ever had a day where you just go, you've done too much today? And then he says, you're not done yet. She was headed to a family reunion in Miami. Actually, she was going to Miami, and then she's going to drive down to the Keys tomorrow with some family. And I said to her, I said, your Aunt Barbara is very sick, and the family is very distraught, and she can't even go on this retreat with the family. And then I sit, and she, at this point, she goes, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And this is one I love. You may hate this, and if you got something inside of you that doesn't like this, so I'm not going to use the word, but I'm going to be close enough that you'll know what she said. She goes, holy. She says, how do you know this? And I said, and actually, I said, a year and a half ago, you're in a relationship with a guy, and it broke up, and you were devastated. And I said, the Lord's going to restore and rebuild your life. She says, how do you know these things? She says, my aunt canceled yesterday because she has cancer. And the whole family is freaking out. Oh, come on.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Lord, more. Give me more. She was crying, just weeping, sitting in that seat, just undone. She said, my whole family's going to hear about this in just a few hours. Oh, that sounds good. Then I asked her, oh, I'm sorry, right before that, I said, you know, you can do this. She said, how do you do it? I said, I hear the Lord. I hear him speaking. I said, you would you like to hear him? Yeah. I said, would you like to receive him right now? Yeah.
Amen.
So she prays and receives the Lord, and was way cool.
Come on.
And then I said to her, who's Kelly? And then she went again, oh, yeah. No way. She said, that's my dad's girlfriend. And her son, I mentioned something about, I told her, I said, tell her everything will be okay. And she said, her son, she's been so worried because her son is having an operation this week and she won't be there. And I said, well, she's going to be okay. We carried on talking. She's crying in and out, crying. I'm like, this is good. Jesus, I like. Then as we're getting ready to get off the plane, Lord begins speaking to me about the flight attendant. And I look at her, and people are going off at the end. And I just waited. I just sat, just waited, because I wanted some space. And I said, I need to share something with you. She said, oh, okay. And I said, the Lord says, do not wait. That things, I said, you're the same age as my daughter, you're 24. She said, yeah. And I said, the Lord says, wait. Do not wait. That 4 years from now, the world's going to be a very different place. And then I said, and I see you with two little babies. Oh my gosh. She's standing bawling. I mean bawling, full on bawling. I'm like, come on. Jesus.
Yeah.
He loves you.
Yeah.
I go and I wait for Dwight to pick me up. I'm outside sitting on a bench there, and there are two guys that are sitting on the bench. And I'm just like, well, this has been a good day. And you know, this is kind of when you look at good days and you go, this one's better. And so they're sitting on the bench. There's room for a third person, but I just said, would you mind if I sat there? And they sit down. So I'm sitting next to them, and the one guy is in his phone like this the whole time, didn't want to acknowledge even that I was there. And the other guy is up looking around, and I looked at him. I said, who's Joseph? And the guy goes, oh, that's my brother. I said, oh. I said, well, and I began telling him, I said, the Lord wants to let you know that he himself is an advocate, and that he's going to be an advocate for your brother, and that even though there are things that we do wrong, sometimes God defends us anyways. And I said, and God's going to defend him. I said, where's Joseph right now? The other guy sits up and says, I'm Joseph.
Come on. I love
that. The Lord had me give them some words about their kids and their families and about the provision, that they didn't need to go in the direction they were going for provision, that God was going to provide. And they said, good. Then I said, can I pray for you? They said, absolutely. I got to pray for them, and then Dwight showed up. But there actually was one more thing that happened, but the guy was from Peru, and so I was able to communicate very briefly, Jesus loves you, but that was about all I could do, because my Spanish really sucks. Which means I probably need to learn it. But God wants to take the church into a very different place than it's been. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the kingdom, but I want to talk to you about the first part of the kingdom. Most people jump immediately to what Jesus said. You're going to heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons, all those things. All those things are very critical. In fact, I could just tell you that you've never experienced the kingdom if you haven't led somebody to Jesus, you haven't cast the demon out, you haven't seen anyone healed through you. You may have experienced the presence of the Lord, but the actual kingdom, the kingdom of God, is not a noun, it's a verb. That the only time the kingdom shows up is when the king is active in it.
Yeah.
And I often tell intercessors, because they go, well, I'm an intercessor, it's like a huge excuse to not do what Jesus said you were going to do anyways. You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the most parts of the earth. Unless you're an intercessor. Actually, what I like to say is that if you're an intercessor, you should be the first one out the door.
Hallelujah.
Knowing you've seen his face, you recognize who he is, and that everybody needs to know this Jesus. Everybody. It's so important that people know that. Because if you do not know that personally in your own lives, you will not go very far. The kingdom only is active when we are active. Sitting and having people teach you, and really they haven't taught you, because the rule of thumb for teaching is that if you teach somebody to do something, you can leave them and they will do what you've actually taught them. If they're not doing anything, you have not been taught. And how many of us, including me, have share a lot of things and there's no change in anybody's life? And I believe that when we begin stepping into that, the Lord himself will do amazing things. We had a woman come in last week from the neighborhood. She brought her dog to our house. And you know, we have like a huge, Saturday we had over 100 people in my house. We had up to 200, but it was a pretty good sized night. And so somebody came and grabbed me for Karen, and hey, somebody here has a dog. It's like, well, you know, we've had people try that before. It's like, it doesn't work, you know, in that kind of a setting. And so it's like, so somebody needs to go talk to this woman. Somebody else comes up and said, hey, your neighbor was walking her dog tonight with her daughter. And the daughter, a five-year-old daughter, said, I want to go to that church. And so this is a neighbor that we didn't know. She lives much further down the road. It was like, whoa. I said, let the dog stay. We're good. That dog sat for 3.5 hours at her feet, never moved the whole time. She said, that's never happened. She wept like a baby as the Spirit of God came on her all night. She said, I've never been in anything like this
before.
What is this? I want you to know that people should understand. Lost people who are going to swear at you, and you're going to have to lose all your virgin ears and just go, my gosh, they're expressing incredible joy.
Yes.
God just did something.
Yes.
that woman bricked today. Oh my gosh. She could have said way worse than that. I would have been like, yes. You're catching it. That's right. This is really weird, isn't it? She said, she kept saying the whole ride, this is crazy. She was like weeping the whole trip. She says, I'm floored. I just don't even know what to do with this. The reality is that what Jesus wants us to release in the kingdom of God has got to stop looking like us and start looking like Jesus.
Yeah.
It's got to start looking like the Holy Spirit's actually moving through us. But the problem is people miss, they jump through hoops thinking things are going to begin happening, but they miss the first part. Do you know the difference between Saul and David? Saul required his heart to be changed. David's heart was already changed. And there are people who do not understand that the first release of what God wants to do in our lives is in us, to us, over us, and shift us. That we're the ones who have to change. Many years ago, you know, when was that? 2003. I was in a meeting in Toronto, Canada. Randy Clark was there, and I just laid on the floor. And Randy happened to be standing there. I'd known him for a number of years. In that time, he'd spoken in our church. Those were in the days where Randy didn't really even get started until after midnight. Oh, I'm not joking. He would ramble on and on until midnight. People, and three quarters of the people would leave. Like, this is crazy. And then after midnight, guess what? Holy Spirit began showing up. People got healed. People got delivered. People got saved. After midnight. It was like a thing that he did. It was like, we've never done a conference like this. But really, when is he going to go to whatever? I was in those meetings. But Randy was there, and God's used him unbelievably around the earth. Unbelievably. I have such honor and respect for him. I love him dearly. But on that day, I was sick and tired of pastoring. I had been doing it way too long. And basically, you know, it kind of gets really old when you preach all these messages and nobody's changing. When I was a vineyard pastor, I'm not joking. I literally would study for 40 hours a week. I would spend time. I mean, I had good stuff. I mean, it was palatable, very, very theologically correct and deep in that regard. But I was just like, this is not it. Something's wrong. And so what happened was I got up. I'm just laying on the floor. I didn't fall. I just went to lay on the floor. And I got up, and he's standing there, and I just said, pray for me, and he didn't. He looked at me, and he said, God's going to give you another chance. And I've never forgotten that. And from that, I got pretty upset, actually. I got a little angry. Went home. I was like, God, it's these people that I'm pastoring that need another chance. And he said, I didn't give that word to them. I gave it to you. And I'll never forget what I said. I said, Lord, you come on me again. I will not stop till the day I see you. Remember the promise I told you I made the Lord? I will not stop till the day I see you. It's amazing how God takes us at our word.
Yeah.
And he's like, me? You want to take my word for it? God, yep. Do. And so as a result, that was when everything kind of started happening. That was within a couple months. I was having visions and being carried off, and I mean incredible for weeks on end about what this mountain of the Lord was. And he began teaching me. I said, why are you using the term mountain? And you know, he said, because people don't understand what the kingdom of God is anymore. And the Old Testament understanding was the mountain of the Lord. Jesus recoined it as the kingdom of God. And he said, I want you to teach it again in a different way. And so that's how that whole thing came. Later on, Bob would have a visitation with the Lord. And the Lord said, he calls me. And he said, Danny, the Lord told me what you're for. I said, oh, really? This is a couple years later. I said, what? He said, he has created you for the mountain of the Lord's presence. When we moved to South Carolina, the words that he gave me is he says, because he told me, he says, I don't want you to get a job. I was looking for a job. I said, I have 9 kids. I need a job. He said, this thing is mine. I want you to go. And so we went. And over and over he would say, and Bob calls me and he goes, the Lord says you're for the mountain. I exist for the mountain. That's why I can go anywhere at any time. It doesn't really matter because the mountain is eternal. It's huge. It's massive. It's the kingdom of God. It will happen in any place and any with any kind of person. It'll happen in conservative churches. It'll happen in charismatic, Pentecostal, Catholic. I've seen the Holy Spirit moving around the world at every different venue. I've seen him in big meetings. I've seen him in tiny meetings. That's why it doesn't bother me. It's like people are like, well, why didn't you just go to big meetings? I said, why? No, well, you know, that's more lucrative. I go, what a horrible understanding you have of the kingdom of God. You mean you go places because of money? You're a hireling? That's what you are? I'm not a hireling. I'm a sent one. I have to go whether I'm paid or not. Many times I have to pay my own way. And many times when I pay my own way, the Lord will say, leave a good offering. See, the nature of the kingdom is very different than the nature of the world. And this past week, the Lord was speaking to me about a couple things, and I wanted to share this because I believe it's a word of the Lord. Absolutely believe this is a word of the Lord. He was talking about the fact that, and this past week, we had four individuals who are part of our group up there, and four of them had amazing encounters with the Lord. One of them actually saw a cherubim with the face of an ox came into their bedroom. Freaked them out. They wake up their husband, we need to pray. I don't know what this thing is, but it scared me. Others were having encounters and dreams and visions. And right now, I'm just telling you, right now, you ready? Amen. Things are heating up, and it's not about the enemy in any way. There are things that have been recently being done in the media to distract what they're not telling you. And because people have become so media intensively watching, looking, hearing, I told people 4 years ago, I said, stop watching.
Amen.
Stop it. You're being moved by all kinds of things. And we watched a generation of people begin to respond directly to a spirit of fear. People became, listen, some people did things very unknowingly. But there were people who absolutely, literally disobeyed the Lord because of the fear in the media or the fear of losing their job. They missed the point. It's okay. We pray for people. Some people are suffering from some of the things as a result of that now. I'm just being, again, truthful. Do I think it matters? At this juncture, no. Guess what? We pray for the sick. We heal people. We see God move and people get back on exactly what God has intended for them. But we do not succumb to fear. We do not succumb to the ploys of the enemy ever, ever again. That some people think, well, that was just a practice run. I'm telling you, it was an incredible, incredible test and trial for us as believers that we understand, no, we're never doing that. Jesus didn't say, you're going to preach the gospel to every creature unless there's a pandemic. He didn't say you're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the world unless there's a pandemic. He never said it. He won't say it now. We'll never say it in the future. He declared what is the most visible, important thing to understand, and that is him and his kingdom. Oh, do you remember what I told you about Jesus and where he is right now? You ready? He left us. This is crazy. He left us in charge. In charge. With the Holy Spirit filling us and in us. He left us. That's what you call authority. Let me just help you. That's in charge. I am giving you charge. But he didn't just leave us with authority. He actually, Luke chapter 9, I think it's verse 2, with power. What? Oh, yeah. It's not just charge. It's not just authority. He says, I'm giving them authority and power. I'm giving both. To overcome every evil ploy of the enemy.
Hallelujah.
And that's significant. But it begins with a place that we don't often think about. Do you remember what Jesus told the disciples first, before he sent them away? Take nothing with you.
Yep.
I want you to be broke.
Yep.
Oh, let me say it again. Jesus was telling his disciples, I want you to go penniless. Were you going, I do not want you to have physical mammon. I do not want you to be wealthy so that you can take care of everything. I want to send you out. In fact, I'm going to make it this difficult for you. Ready? You're going to feel like you're sheep among wolves. I'm going to send you out in the exact opposite of what you think you need. I've been hearing all kinds of things by the Spirit, and then I hear some things, and there is absolutely, there is about to happen. Hear me. Remember I said the media is hiding things from you?
Yeah.
Hear me. Please hear me. There is about to be a new finance.
Yeah.
I'm not talking crypto.
Yeah.
I'm not talking what exists. Yeah. One of these people had this incredible dream this past week. Now, I knew things before this, but I'd been on, but this just marked it. And there were these birds that you can recognize from Babylonian literature who were dropping coins. Incidentally, these birds were gold. And the interesting thing is that we as people, we generally think of gold as God. Let me help you with something. Babylon was known as gold in the statue with Daniel. Can I say that again?
Yeah. Yeah.
That gold reflected the Babylonian spirit. What? Now I know that the Lord says, the gold is mine, the silver is mine. I get that. But sometimes we misinterpret the timings of a lot of things. And in this particular dream this person had, it was so remarkable. I was like, oh my gosh. These birds were releasing coins, and there were fishermen that were fishing out the coins. And then the next scene was that they were using these coins to build this stuff right as they were crucifying many, many many believers. I went, oh my gosh. They said, you don't know what that, I said, you don't know what that, and they said, no. I said, I know what that means. The Lord says, I want you to teach about the kingdom. Yeah. I knew this weekend I'm going to talk about the kingdom. I'm probably not talking exactly in some of the terms that you've heard. He said, I want you to teach them about the kingdom. Let them know this. Let's go to Galatians chapter 6, if you will. The Lord says, the church doesn't understand, for the most part, that they have been taught to invest, even by Christian people. They've been taught to invest in the things that are earthly mammon. And they have believed that that is going to cultivate for them a better future and life. They do not understand. I have never looked to earthly mammon as a resource for me. Wait, did you hear me?
Yeah.
Now, in Ecclesiastes, it actually says this. You ready? Everyone knows that it's money that makes everything happen. You ready? On the earth. I'll use another verse real quickly in 2 Thessalonians 1. It says, Now, if you will not work, basically, if anyone will not work, they shall not eat. You know that verse?
Yeah.
It's used usually on young men.
Yeah.
Because they won't work. They don't want to work. It's lazy. It's like, no, I'm just trusting God. And, but the interesting thing about that passage is you have to understand this. What was this book written for? What's this book about? What's it about? How's it teamed up? By Jesus. And we always revert to the natural things. So we go, if you won't work, you're not going to eat. If you won't work in the kingdom, you won't eat. I know people who make multi-millions who barely survive. What? Why? Because they don't understand the kingdom. They're living by the world's economy. They might have, and there are many people I know who have 3 and 4 jobs, and they're just trying to make ends meet. You hear that all the time. And they're doing whatever they can to make enough. They don't understand. No, it's when you don't work in the kingdom that you won't eat. What? It's always prioritizing everything in our life, everything. When you come to Jesus, you didn't come to Jesus just so that you could have a good life. In fact, the opposite would be mostly true. Jesus never said, this is a health and wealth, socially acceptable, I just want to mature you and grow you, and it's going to be wonderful, and I'm going to take care of all your issues and your social issues and everything, and that everything is going to be beautiful. He said, I want you to follow me. And anybody who follows me is going to have to carry a cross. Everyone, and when anybody picks up that cross, I want you to understand, nobody returned who was carrying a cross. They all knew, my life is spent. I spent my life years ago. I said, Jesus, I'm following you to the end. Doesn't matter if I die here, die there. It doesn't really matter. I don't care. I'm following you. My life is not my own. It has been bought with a price. But we tend to separate these two things, and we think, well, you know, yeah, but you know, let's get practical. That's where people always come. Let's get practical. I have lived impractically now since 2003. I said, Lord, in 1997, I said, Lord, 1997, 98, I said, Lord, I would like the privilege of living by faith like George Mueller.
Yeah.
The Lord said to me later on, 2003, he says, I want you to live by faith without hints. I don't want you to send out prayer requests. I don't want you to have partners. I don't want you to do this. I don't want you to do that. He said, I want you to trust me. That's much easier said than done.
Yes.
Are you ready? He has never failed us. I'm living in the largest house I've ever lived in. I never know, my gosh, I mean, sometimes the heat. I live in New England. We had 1 2-month period where literally our heating over that 2-month cold winter was $5,000. I had no clue where it came from or how it got paid. We were never late. We have, to this day, never been late. Because the economy of the kingdom is very different than the economy of God, than the economy of the world. And the economy of the world wants to have security, wants to have assurances, wants to have certain points. And this is where, no, I'll give this much, but no further. And so when I've said in the past, people look at me and like, you're nuts. And it's like, no, I'm not really nuts. I, you know, Jesus is there looking at the Pharisees and the widow. And he says to the widow, he said, she's giving more than they've all given. And so I've made this comment, and people don't like this comment. The more money you have, the less you like what I'm about to say. You all can be the widow. It's just that your might might be a lot bigger than that widow's might. Are you with me? Because they gave out of what they had. She gave all she had. She understood the kingdom economy. That's what Jesus was saying. She understood something that most Christians today do not understand. We are in a self-preservation mode. I got to save for this. I got to do for this. I got to do for this. But in fact, the kingdom of God, the foundation, and let me explain something to you. If you do not get this, you will never see the next part of the kingdom, like healing the sick, casting out demons, raising the dead. You just won't. Because you've missed the basic principle of the kingdom, and it only happens when you are all in. You can't try to pray for the sick. Jesus never told us to try to pray for the sick. He said, I want you to heal the sick. In fact, he didn't say anything about praying. We've added that because it looks good. But Jesus never said pray for the sick. Never did. The passage of James says this. It says, is anybody sick? Let them call the elders of the church. That the prayer of faith, and we totally wreck that. So what we do, somebody gets really, really sick, and we call the elders of the church. We say, would you guys come pray? That wasn't the point. The point was is that Jesus never lied. And Jesus said, if you lay hands on the sick, they'll be healed. Yeah. Did you hear me?
Yeah.
That's what Jesus said. Jesus didn't say, call the elders and get the special ops teams and get the ones who really are equipped and that know how to heal the sick and they got special gifts of power to do this. He said, lay hands on the sick, they'll get better. I know this is going to happen to your husband. I don't have a doubt.
Hallelujah.
I don't have a doubt.
Amen.
But what happens is you have to be all in. And until you learn the principle of all in, you will not understand the foundations of the kingdom of God, which are the power of God. And in order to receive that power, there has to be a faith in you that is what has happened to me over and over and over. The Lord says, back yourself into a corner.
Hallelujah.
Right.
Tell her about her Aunt Barbara. Back yourself into a corner.
Yeah.
Ask her who Carol is. Back yourself in the corner. Make it so difficult. That was the crime in Isaiah when the king was given the opportunity. Isaiah said to him, ask the Lord for a sign. Make it difficult. God is looking for people that will make things so difficult, like, oh my gosh, how is God going to recover from this one? Because they believe God. And the king wouldn't do it. And the rebuke to him from Isaiah was, how would you not only offend the people, but you're offending God himself. Therefore, the Lord himself will give a sign. A virgin shall be with child. Let's pick something tough. Are you with me? There's something about pressing into that place called faith that just doesn't operate when you try. That's why we pray and we pray and we pray and nothing ever happens. But there's something where we say, get up. That's the only way I've ever seen people get out of wheelchairs. The only way I've ever seen the blind see. It's the only way I've ever seen the deaf hear. And there's something God wants to do that. So let's go on. Ready? Galatians. I know you think I forgot, but I didn't. Galatians chapter 6. You ready? Verse 7. Now we use this everywhere, but I want to pull out one piece. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. What does that mean? It means yeah, he's not mocked. That's good. God knows what's going on in your hearts. He's not mocked. You might say, God, I'm trying. God, I want to. God, I tried. God, I've done. Right? God's not mocked. He goes, really? Really? And then he goes on. He said, For whatever a person sows, he will also reap. And we go, yeah, of course, that's how it works. But look what he talks about sowing and reaping. Because the one who sows to his what?
Flesh.
Let's just change that a little bit. When you sow into the things that are in the natural realm. Can you hear that?
Yeah.
We all think, oh, it's my flesh, and this is for me. Now, when you sow into the natural realm, you're going to reap destruction. You could lose. I dare not ask anybody to show their hands how many lost a whole lot of money even just a little while ago. Maybe they were in crypto, or maybe they were in something else, and they lost all kinds of things, and they thought this was the new thing. Or maybe you lost something in the fall that happened in 2007. The crash stuff, and all your investment was there, and what would you reap? You reaped destruction. Why? Because that's all it can offer you.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's all natural. But the one who sows to the Spirit, I'm going to give you a way forward. I'm going to give you a way forward that is 100% God. It's biblical, it's sound in every way, and I'm going to use another verse in just a minute. Where you begin to understand, wait a second, I'm investing, I'm using my money to make money here, but God, that's not even a value to God. God could give a rip about money. He owns a cattle on 1,000 hills, and he doesn't give a rip, you know, it's like, go buy yourself a cow, I don't care. They really belong to me. On and on and on. And people invest, and they think, this is it. And it's amazing how many schemes there are in the body of Christ to try and figure out how to make natural money. So many. Oh, my gosh. I know two guys in New England who, under the leadership of somebody who they said was an apostle, literally, and I'm not talking about like a far-fetched person, two of them lost their homes. Oh, this is the Lord. I remember a few years ago. I hope I'm not treading on toes, but I might. I remember when the Iraqi dinar was going to revalue. It was going to be worth so much. How much are you going to give? How much are you going to buy? And basically, here's what I did. I said, well, how much money do I really don't care about losing? That I don't really care. And that if they're right, that's wonderful, but I don't think they are. But I literally gave what I didn't really care about. They were quite disappointed. They wanted me to give a lot more. But I just kind of nickled it, you know. I think I gave $100. That's all you're going to get? That means you're only going to get like $85,000. And if I give 100 and I get 85,000, I'll be happy. But honestly, I don't really think that's going to happen. But they were so convinced. And it was amazing. They had all these radio shows and all these things you need to watch and you need to follow through. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I don't have time to listen to all this. No, I'm not going to. But they said, please do it, please. And I was like, here's $100. I don't care. It's just my, you know, money, we hate for it to be spent, but sometimes the best thing we can ever do is just give it away. In fact, I've learned that when I am most broke, this is truth. When I am most broke, guess what I do? I give more.
Bridget.
I like slaughter. My line of poverty. My line of, oh my gosh. But I go, I need breakthrough in some things, so I'm just going to give a lot more. I'm going to sow into, but you ready? You know where I sow? I don't sow into investments. I sow into the kingdom. I just sow, you know, it's like, and sometimes I sow into these little tiny little places, like, right, no way. Anything's coming back from that. He's perfect. God likes that. God likes it when you just overwhelm. Overwhelm your unbelief.
Yes. That's good.
With incredible gratitude and commitment. I just love what you're doing, God. Thank you for keeping me in a place where I have to have faith.
Hallelujah.
Thank you. I'm not talking, listen, I've been in the offerings, dude. I never forget an offering we had a few years ago, more than a few, and I'm glad. Where literally, man, there were guys guarding the door. You couldn't get out during the offering. They said, now we know, I'm not joking. Have any of you ever been in a service like this? Well, some of you have, some of you haven't. It's a real treat.
I think we need a budget for that.
Yeah. And what happens, hey guys, good to see you. They're from Florida. That's Richard Gunn. And but they they're waiting. And they said, who here has $1,000 to give? You stand up. And I've seen it both ways, where there's been a prophetic word for those who give, which, man, that's, you want to run from that thing.
Yeah,
there are bolts of lightning about ready to come. Listen, never buy a prophetic word. You ready? I'll give you a more sure chance of knowing that you did the wrong thing. Go to a palm reader or something like that. Give them your money, because at least you're going to know, man, I did something really wrong. The other way, you're just going to feel guilty that you aren't giving and that you really need a word, so you're okay. Don't do it. Never. And frankly, stay away from people who do that. Well, I'm being pretty honest, aren't I? But I'll never forget this particular meeting. Oh my gosh. If you have 1,000, come. If you have $750, come. If you have 500, if you have 400, 300. They stopped. They said, now I said, and then they said, I'd like everybody to stand who's given already.
Oh no.
Yeah, I'm not joking. They had to go down front and give it, but then they came back and stand up. Then they said, now I want you to look at the people who are sitting, because God's not blessing them.
Oh my gosh.
I'm not joking, this is true. True story. And they said, he said, those of you who God is blessing, I want you to give them money so they have something to bring up here and give. I was like, man, God, why was I here? He said, you're learning. I said, I learned something today. The one who sows, what? To the natural realm. When you sow into the things that basically the earth has control over, from that realm you will reap destruction. But the one who will sow to the spirit or into the kingdom will reap. Will what?
Reap.
Say it, reap.
Reap.
From eternal life. Do you know what he's saying with that? This is not just a good feeling of eternal life. This is literally the very life of God will begin to break forth in your life.
Amen.
Why? Because you have seen the priority. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 6. One of my favorite verses. It's probably some of yours as well. But I love this. I love this passage. Now I just have a couple more things and we're going to finish. What did I say? Matthew chapter 6. That's right. Remember that offering I was just talking about? Look at verse 1. We're not going to read this, but now we are. Be careful not to practice your righteousness in front of others to be seen by them. Be real sneaky about giving. Give where nobody can notice, but it's like, oh my gosh. Because if they notice, they may go, whoa. Not to be recognized. One of the greatest disservices in the body of Christ is when, particularly when pastors and leaders begin honoring the wealthy in their midst because they know what they give. They don't realize they're setting themselves up for a grand removal. You love everybody. You love the widow who has a mite. And you love the millionaire because they love Jesus. You just love them all the same. And for some reason, God has shown fit that some have actually become, how can I put it, wise stewards, that God can trust them with maybe more than he can trust you with. I know you don't want to hear that. So let's jump over in chapter 6, verse 19. Don't store up for yourselves treasures where? The earth or the ground. Oh. I don't know if that speaks to you, it speaks to me all the time. For where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store for yourselves treasures in heaven, where?
Heaven.
How do you store treasures in heaven? You know, you go, man, I can't get into heaven. I haven't figured that one out yet. Or, you know, in my walk with the, well, the Lord says, basically when you give to what? His kingdom, his purposes. And I'm not just talking about the normal where people are saying, well, you need to give here, you need to give here. And I'm not going to establish those boundaries for you. I love the boundary of Abraham with Melchizedek. Melchizedek blessed him, and as a result, he went, yo, don't go anywhere. There's something about that when we absolutely pour into the lives of people in our lives, and sometimes they aren't even doing ministry, but they're doing kingdom. They live as in the kingdom. We go, yeah, but I won't get a tax write-off on this. Hallelujah. I've been praying for years. I don't even tell you what I'm praying, but I will tell you. Some of you would be angry at me. I've been praying for years that the tax-exempt nature, where we give so we get back at the end of the year.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, you haven't given anything yet.
Right. Yeah.
You know, in Australia and other parts, they give. They get nothing back at the end of the year. They're not giving to get back. They don't need the report at the end of the year because they actually want it to go to the kingdom of God. I'm not going to tell you what to do. I think you can give. You can give under a tax-exempt thing, but let me just tell you, you should give enough that at the end of the year, that when you can claim what it is, that you are not able to claim nearly as much as you've given, and you actually have given. I think that's biblical. Dwight, did you like that? For where your treasure is, your heart will be also. Now jump down to verse 24. No one can serve what? Two masters. Since either he will hate one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve both God and money. And then the last verse. Let's go. What he's talking about, this is the context. This is the context. It's why. Remember about practical? We're going to get practical here. Don't worry about life. Don't worry about what you can eat, or what you can drink, or what you can wear. What? Yep, that's the context. It's the same context that we all have, where we are basically saying, well, God, you know, I can only give this much because I got all this to pay. This is your worry. You're worried about sustaining your own personal life. He says, consider the birds. Consider the lilies. Can any worrying add one moment to your lifespan?
Is that really going to help? Stop worrying. Give it up. Give it up. Look at your bank account and say, I'm not going to worry about it anymore. I'm going to spend it on the kingdom, and all hell is going to hate me. I've never taught this message before, have I? Verse 31. So don't worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what will we drink? Or what will we wear? For you ready? The Gentiles. Oh, let me just make it clearer for you. Worldly, ungodly people do that. Oh, did I make it too close? Worldly, ungodly people worry. What are you saying, Jesus? I'm telling you, worldly and ungodly people worry. Don't be like them. Why? Remember what I said this is the foundation of? Faith. See, when you believe God will take care of you, when you understand that God is your Father, that God is leading you, God is directing you, when you begin to understand that, you've begun to enter into the kingdom. Because you go, this world doesn't owe me. And it doesn't owe me. This world's not my home. I am a stranger and an alien. You know, they're talking about aliens right now. I think we're getting talked about, guys. We're making the press. There are aliens here. It's us. We're it. And by the Spirit, we can make lightning fast turns and moves. I'm playing with you. Verse 33. Well, actually, 32. The lost, the pagan, the Gentiles, they do those things. And your Heavenly Father knows. He didn't forget. He didn't miss you. Oh, no, he's late. Well, Jesus was late a couple times. In fact, sometimes he's 4 days late at the body stage. But that was no reason to doubt. Verse 33, here it is. But seek first, put first, the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. What's that mean? You prioritize him and his purposes, and he will prioritize facilitating your life on the earth. I can tell you, I travel everywhere, not because I have this incredible bank account. You would laugh at my bank account. I travel everywhere because the Lord says go. And I've decided to seek first the kingdom. I've decided that obedience is actually the most important thing in the earth as a kingdom person. That I am not allowed to say, God, you haven't provided enough yet for me to do that. It's the poorest excuse in the world. Jesus never asked anybody to go because he's provided. He's told you to go, and then he will go. He is not obligated to take care of Christians. This is where people miss a lot. God never obligates himself to take care of people who've said a prayer, go and sit in a church, and nothing else happens in their life. Never. He obligates himself to those who seek first, prioritize first the kingdom of God. You can't begin to know the kingdom. You cannot begin to know faith. You cannot begin to know what it means. You know, some of us just have learned we want to do the supernatural. We want signs and wonders. We want those things, and we've gone after them in the past. And I remember there was a period of time where everybody was just like after these crazy meetings so that they would see something. The reality is God doesn't want you just to see things. He wants you to live in it. The supernatural becomes a part of our life. Angels are a regular part of my life. A few weeks ago, I drove up to my house, and I thought there were like 30 or 40 angels, maybe 50, in my yard. And the Lord said, no, it's just 17. They're just moving really fast. And then he said this, Danny, they are always here. They're here watching over your property, watching over your family, and being breath to those around them. They will never leave the neighbors to the Lord. Angels can't do that. They don't carry redemption. They've never been redeemed. We are the ones who carry the message that only redeemed people can carry. But they will open doors for us. They're used as messengers to help us, to assist us. But they're not the ones who preach. There's one, the end of the age, it says there'll be one angel that will cover the earth with the gospel. But all it's giving is the message of the gospel, not what we carry. We carry the most amazing thing because we've been redeemed. We've been forgiven, and no angel ever was. It's amazing. Powerful. What you carry inside of you, you have to begin to believe the power of God is the gospel. And it is full of power. This gospel is full of power. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation. It has so much power. And it's in you. When you receive the Lord, that's in you. And it is intended to radically alter your life. If your life doesn't look very much different than before you said the prayer, it's right that you answer. I was having a good conversation with my son the other day. And I began sharing with him a vision the Lord gave me back in the 80s, and where Jesus stood over a church and he cut this church in two, and a part of it went off into oblivion. Another part came up, became part of the bride. And the Lord spoke to me. He said, Danny, over half the people who go to church do not even know me. They've been given a message. They've said, yeah, I said the prayer. And they think that's the end of the deal. And the end of the deal is not that. That you weren't saying a prayer, I hate to tell you, just to simply get into heaven. Yeah. You were actually asking Jesus to run your life, to lead your life, that you would follow him all your days, that you would be a disciple, that you were willing to lay down everything, whether that be you, whether it be your family, whether it be everything you own, you're willing to lay it all down for the sake of knowing him, not for your own sake, but for the sake of knowing him and that he's worthy of it all. We're in that moment right now. And God's raising up. Things have shifted huge. Huge. We are not in playtime anymore. This is the real deal. This is the real deal. Yeah. He's a God who looks to the past and covers things over. Even when we think we can't cover them over, but he covered them over. And he says, you're remembering too much of your past for your future because you thought you would walk through with this one, but the Lord said no. Because they said no, but the Lord says to you, you follow me. Yeah, those who are dead bury the dead. But the Lord says, follow me. He's after you. In this moment, the Lord says, all those encounters you had way back then, they were meaningful. Do not discount them. Some of those things were for today, not for back then. Begin to remember. Remember your future. Remember what the Lord spoke to you. Remember what he said to you. You thought, I'd be a lot younger. The Lord says, no, you won't be. You're not alone.
Amen.
God God's an amazing God. And he is so faithful, isn't he? Yeah. You haven't even begun to see provision yet. Not at all. It's like you've been picking apart life trying to figure out how do I make this work better. Or says, I've already got it planned out for you. Trust me. And jump. Jump. See, little one. In your mind, that's who they are. The Lord says he's about to bring redemption and healing to their heart as well. Because he's a God who's faithful. And you delivered him to the Lord. And the Lord did not forget the promise you made. And the Lord has never forgotten the promise that he made you. Do not be in fear. He is a good, good, good God. Put your hand in your stomach for a second. Lord, right now, I release complete healing on the inside, the outside. And Father, that there will be a release, Father, right now, of healing all over your daughter. Thank you. There it comes. There it comes. No more anguish. No more anguish on the inside, even physically. No more anguish. No more. There's going to be peace in this belly. There's going to be peace. Everything's about to calm down. Everything's about to calm, 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 calm. There it is. There it is. There it is. There it is. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. The Lord wants to change something about how you reference yourself. He says, I want you to reference yourself as a faithful one. He said, you need to perceive yourself in new light. That you're faithful. You just keep going. And you will. He's so good. He's so good. He's so good. He's so good. Sure. Wow. Wow. I think it's Marcella, might be Mark. Who is that? Or Marcella. You know Mark, okay? Who is Mark? Okay. Good. Yeah, but which one came, the cousin came to your mind first? All right, that's fine. So we're just going to pray for Mark. Oh, no, you don't understand how important this is. The Lord's about to reel him in. And it's going to change everything in the whole family's life. Chris says, I'm going to reel him in so close. He'll begin speaking to him. He's about to have an encounter with the Lord that's going to shift and change everything. Not only in his life, but through the family. The Lord's going to release an incredible fire all over his life. But let me talk to you for a second. God is not slow. No, look at me. He's not slow. Sometimes we as humans are slow. Sometimes we as humans don't catch the drift. We're naive sometimes, you know? We don't get hints. But the Lord doesn't need hints. When the Lord makes a promise, he fulfills it. And the Lord says, I'm about to fulfill the promise. And fill your heart. Fill your heart. Capture your heart with the desires, not just for God, but for the fulfillment of your life and the healing of your life in every regard. The Lord says, I'm going to restore years that were eaten by the devourer, particularly when you were young and he decimated you and you've never known how you recover. I'm telling you, the Lord right now, tonight, is releasing a healing and a freedom to you. And not only that, the Lord says, my promise is sure. And this one will come carrying healing with them. They're going to walk in a maturity and in a godliness like you've never, ever known in another. You need to hear that. Because the Lord says you can't compromise and God's not slow. He's bringing it about now, 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 now. More, Lord. More, Lord. More, Lord. More, Lord. I see two houses next to each other. They're like a townhouse. What do you call those?
Duplex.
A duplex. It's like a duplex. And the Lord says that things happen in that duplex that will never happen in your life ever again, ever again, ever again. That the Lord is going to clear out the house. And the Lord says that there's going to be a release. There's actually going to be ready. There's going to be some recompense that not for you, not from you, but for you, that the Lord is about to bring about. See, we tend to think, well, God, in your faithfulness and grace, you won't hurt. You won't do that to anybody. But when the Lord makes a promise, he always fulfills his promise, or we would never be able to believe him again. Do you hear me? And so the Lord is righteous. But it is God who holds the vengeance, not us. And so I release that completely from you tonight. That will never be on your life. But the Lord says, but you will watch and you will see. And you will know that God was faithful. God did this thing. God did this thing. God did this thing. He's so good. More, Lord. More, Lord. He's good, isn't he? Good. You got Jesus all over you. You really do. You're so tender towards the Lord. You're like a Mary sitting at his feet. That's what he says. You have chosen the better things. He said, get ready. I saw you in a slingshot. You already know this. But you're in a slingshot because he's about to send you out. He says, your heart has to go to the most broken, to the most destitute. Your heart has to go there because it represents Jesus, because it is Jesus. And the Lord says, never fear, I'll take you. I'll take you in some of the most hideous places. And he says, some of those things you will not even see. What's happening? Because you'll carry the heartbeat of Jesus to pull people out of the gutter, out of their addictions. That's a good one for family, isn't it? Isn't it?
Wow.
And God touches even our own. And God touches the ones we love the most. I love it. I love it. Jesus, you're amazing. You're amazing. You're amazing. You're amazing. Lord, tonight, we shatter the chains of the enemy. Everybody ready? On your family. On this family. On everyone. We just shatter them in Jesus' name. We break the power. For the enemy has come to steal, kill, and he's doing his job. but we're going to do ours. And it's not even the same. I hope sometime this weekend to talk to you about warfare, because some of you got it all wrong. You've been doing weird stuff for a long time. And it looks cool. But it has no power to set people free. Wow. I literally saw, or since you're about to see people coming up to you in the most random places and just handing you money. It's like, well, what are they doing? You're not asking, but they're coming. They're just going to give it to you. They're just going to say, I'm supposed to do this. And the Lord says, I'm going to provide for you supernaturally. Your whole life. Your whole life. Yeah. And you're the one wondering, what's going to happen? And I don't wonder if anything will happen. Because I need something to happen, God. Isn't God good? Come on. He loves you. He loves you. You are so precious to him. He loves you dearly. You literally carry his presence. Do you know that? Don't ever discount that. You can look in the mirror and say, I carry his presence. This is what his presence looks like. For real. For real. I love you too, precious. I love your heart. Love it. Wow. Wow. He's good, isn't he?